WJXT, the morning show starts now.
And when you're not feeling well, what do? Do you Google before you go to the doctor? Is that information you're getting online credible? Well, it may not be that good. It could be a bad prescription for your health. We find out more coming up. When you're not feeling well, you know, you assume, okay, maybe I'll go to the doctor. But some people instead go to Google and they try and see what's wrong with them. Joining us now, Dr. Kalpana Di Pasquale. Hey, good
how
to have
you
here.
Thank
That's
you.
Not always the best idea.
No, it's not. And I think it's really about how you utilize Google, or Dr. Google, as I like to call it. You have to use it in the right way, and then it can be very, very effective.
So what you're saying is it's okay to be an educated consumer, but Absolutely. Don't take what you read online as gospel.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, a lot of times what people will do is they'll go on the internet, they'll start searching a myriad of symptoms, and the problem is that the symptom checkers are not very accurate. They're only accurate about 34% of the time. And then the patient will come in and say, oh, this is exactly what I have. I think it's okay to be aware of the possibilities of what you've got, but not depend on Dr. Google for your exact diagnosis.
And it causes worry. Can I share this picture that you put on your Facebook page?
Sure.
It concerns this mug. All right, take a look at this photo. It says, please don't confuse your Google search with my medical degree. See, because the bottom line is that doctors take a multitude of things into consideration here. All right, let's talk about some of the myths that are out there. Somebody says, I've got chronic headaches. I went online, I've got a brain tumor.
Exactly. And that's, you know, what it is, and you know, the mug isn't meant to be condescending. It's just supposed to be funny, because the bottom line is people look on the internet and then they've got their exact diagnosis. So it changes the doctor-patient relationship. So for example, you've Googled a headache and you've got a brain tumor. Sometimes it takes me 15, 20 minutes to convince them that, well, I don't think they've got a brain tumor. And they are very fearful, and sometimes they're often misled. So those are the issues that we face.
I guess some of the other misconceptions. I've got throat pain. I've got sinus pain. And that's cancer.
Exactly. Exactly. And the funny thing is that head and neck cancers don't often present with pain. So it's usually something else, like TMJ or something else, tonsillitis. And often something very, very simple can be misconstrued as cancer. Head and neck cancers actually present more so with a neck mass, difficulty swallowing, hoarseness for a prolonged period of time. Something that's a little more insidious than frank onset of acute pain.
How do you vet some of that information? So you go in and you say, okay, you know what, this is a little more concerning than just a sore throat, and maybe I do have to follow up.
It's really the length of time. So, you know, if you've got something going, if you've got something going on a couple of days, most likely it's just an infection. But if it's going on for weeks or months, it's really the length of time that should make you alerted that you may want to see a physician, and the presence of other symptoms, you know, weight loss, neck masses, difficulty swallowing, and things that are more serious.
Have you ever had a patient come to you and say, Dr. D, I read this online, and I think you're wrong.
Yes. And that's the other thing. I think that it's really okay to be a very educated consumer, but it's another thing. I think that people have to have mutual respect for each other. So if you've read something online, you have these concerns, certainly bring it up to your doctor. But I think it really is a doctor-patient collaboration that is really, really important. But obviously, if you're saying that to your physician, it kind of puts us on the defensive, and it may not be the best visit in the world.
And it's okay, by the way, to ask for a second opinion if it's a critical diagnosis.
Absolutely.
You're not going to hurt the doctor's feelings.
No, absolutely not. I mean, I think doctors are professional enough to understand that patients are educated. They may want another opinion, and there's nothing wrong with any of that. But, you know, that frank mistrust of, hey, I read this on the internet, and it's definitely that, that doesn't usually go so well. I think we have to have a mutual respect for each other.
Is there any one website or place that people can go where there is some modicum of credibility?
Well, I mean, WebMD is probably one of the better websites just to get some good insight on your symptoms and your diagnosis. But again, anything you will check on WebMD will come up with a myriad of diagnoses. So it really takes a medical professional to sort through all that, because it can be often overwhelming for people to look through all that information. It gets pretty scary after a while.
Which is worse to ask, the internet or your grandmother? We'll leave that question unanswered.
Yeah, I don't know about that one.
Doc, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
If you missed any of this interview, you can watch it online at newsforjax.com. Look on the morning show page. Should be up around 10:30 or 11 this morning.